And what's going to happen?
And thou shalt be a father of many nations.
This is a man who has no children, who has no seed at this time. He said, you're going to be a father of what? Of many nations. Go ahead.
Neither shall thy name anymore be called Abram.
Well, what?
But thy name shall be Abraham.
And why is that?
For a father of many nations have I made thee.
So he changed his name to Abraham. And he said, a father of many nations I've made thee. Go ahead.
And I will make thee exceeding fruitful. And I will make nations of thee. And kings shall come out of thee.
Go ahead.
And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant.
So the agreement that God is making with Abraham is an everlasting covenant. It is forever. Go ahead.
To be a God unto thee,
unto
thy seed after thee.
Go ahead. And what else is the Lord going
to
do?
And I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee.
Go ahead.
The land wherein thou art a stranger. All the land of Canaan for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God.
The Lord has made a covenant with Abraham. And what he proposes to him, he's going to give him the land of Canaan. That's why it's called the promised land. It was promised unto Abraham and to his seed for an everlasting possession. But in order for Abraham to inherit this land forever, what does that mean? What he's letting him know is, you're going to have eternal life, Abraham. And all those that are obedient unto God, this same promise has been made unto him, unto them. He said, but I'm going to give unto thee and thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession. He says, and I will be their God. Go ahead.
And God said unto Abraham,
what?
Thou shalt keep my covenant therefore. Thou and thy seed after thee in their generations.
And in order to keep the covenant, what had to take place? Abraham had to walk before God and be perfect. And so does his seed. They also have to be obedient. If you ever wanted to partake in this covenant, they had to be obedient unto God. Go ahead.
This is my covenant, which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee.
Because he's going to give him a sign of this covenant. Go ahead.
Every man child among you shall be circumcised.
And we're going to see what the circumcision is for. Go ahead.
And ye shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin. And it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you.
It's going to be a sign. The circumcision is a sign of the covenant between him and God. Go ahead.
And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised among you. Every man child in your generations, he that is born in the house, or bought with money of any stranger which is not of thy seed.
It's one law for everybody. God gave his word unto Israel, and Israel was supposed to teach the rest of the sons of Adam about the true and living God. So he told them, as a sign of the covenant, he said that he is to circumcise everybody that is of his household, and also the stranger. He that is born in the household, bought with money of any stranger, which is not of thy seed, even though he's not physically from Abraham, still he had to be circumcised. Had he not, in order to be a part of the covenant. But go ahead. Because God is showing us here. He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but he is the God of all people. He is not a respecter of person. Whoever is willing to obey him, then they can receive the promises that he's put forth. But go ahead.
He that is born in thy house,
and
he that is bought with thy money,
what?
Must needs be circumcised.
Go ahead.
And my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant.
So he's letting you know everybody that wants to partake of this covenant has to do what? They have to be circumcised. And this is ongoing. He said, he that is born in thy house, and he that is bought with thy money, must needs be circumcised. He says, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. Again, this is for everybody. It's one law for all. Go ahead.
And the uncircumcised man child, whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised.
What's going to happen?
That soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant.
So the Lord is letting you know, you have a choice. You have free will. You don't have to obey God, but then still there are consequences that you are going to face. But drop down to verse number 19 and go ahead. Because again, he's entering into this covenant with Abraham. And it's about Abraham and his seed. And now he's going to address that fact. Because again, at this point, Abraham and his wife have had no offspring. Go ahead.
And God said, Sarah thy wife shall bear thee a son indeed.
And what's going to happen?
And thou shalt call his name Isaac.
So the Lord is telling Abraham again, you're going to have a child, you're going to have a son. And he's telling him what it is, what name he's to give him. He says, Sarah your wife shall bear thee a son indeed, even though she's up in age. And thou shalt call his name what? Thou shalt call his name Isaac. And what is the Lord going to do?
And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant.
Go ahead.
And with his seed after him.
God is omniscient. He knows all things. Because the covenant that he's making with Abraham is continued upon Abraham being what? Being obedient. Is it not? And God knows that Abraham is going to obey him. So it's letting him know, the child that you're going to have, Abraham, you're going to name him Isaac. And I'm going to establish my covenant with him because he knows that Abraham is going to be obedient to him. He said, I'm going to establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and with his seed after him. Turn over to Genesis, the 22nd chapter. That God has did as he promised. And Sarah bore a child, a son, and called him Isaac. And the Lord is getting ready to try Abraham concerning his son, Isaac. 22 and verse number 1. You go ahead when you get there.
And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham.
Go ahead.
And said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here I am.
And what did he tell Abraham? Go ahead.
And he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of.
Again, the Lord is telling Abraham to offer his son as a sacrifice. And what did Abraham do? Go ahead.
And Abraham rose up early in the morning.
Then questioned God. This is a man who truly does believe. He said Abraham rose up early in the morning. And did what?
And saddled his ass. And took two of his young men with him.
Go ahead.
And Isaac his son. And claimed the wood for the burnt offering. And rose up. And went unto the place of which God had told him.
Go ahead.
Then on the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes. And saw the place afar off.
He had got to the place where the Lord had told him of. And he knew now it was the time for the sacrifice. So he told his young man to do what? Go ahead.
And Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass. And I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you.
Drop down verse number 7 and go ahead. What did Isaac do?
And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father. And said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. And he said, behold the fire and the wood.
Now Isaac understood what was getting ready to take place. He had been taught by Abraham how to do service to the Almighty God. Isaac spake unto Abraham, his father, said, my father. And he said, here am I, my son. And he said, what? Behold the fire and the wood. Go ahead.
But where is the lamb for a burnt offering?
So looking at the circumstances, he knew a sacrifice was to be made. But he also realized there was no animal there to sacrifice. So he's questioning Abraham concerning this. And what did Abraham say? Go ahead.
And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering.
And the Lord truly did do that in the way of Jesus. But I'm not dealing with that now. He said, and Abraham said, my son, God will provide him a lamb for a burnt offering. Go ahead.
So they went both of them together. And they came to the place which God had told him of.
Go ahead.
And Abraham built an altar there. And laid the wood in order.
Go ahead.
And bound Isaac his son. And laid him on the altar upon the wood.
Abraham is getting ready to kill his son. He's getting ready to kill Isaac. Because he is fulfilling fulfilling the commandment that God gave unto him. He told him to sacrifice his son Isaac, and Abraham is getting ready to do that. Go ahead.
And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son.
Go ahead. And what happened?
And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham.
Go ahead.
And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad.
What was established here was Abraham in his mind was ready to commit the act. He was going to kill Isaac and sacrifice him unto the Lord. The angel of the Lord stopped him from doing so. He said, Lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. And why is that?
For now I know that thou fearest God.
And how does he know? Because Abraham evidenced it just by his profession of belief? No, but by his actions. He showed that he truly did believe in the true and living God. Go ahead. He said, For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing what?
Seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me.
Drop down to verse number 15 and go ahead.
And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time.
And listen to what he said.
And said, By myself have I sworn, saith the Lord. For because thou hast done this thing.
What?
And hast not withheld thy son, thine only son.
What's going to happen?
That in blessing I will bless thee. And in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven.
He said, Abraham, because you've been obedient unto me. That's what we have to recognize in this. That's what's important. Not because you just simply profess to believe. He said, because you've done this thing and has not withheld thy son, thine only son. Because you've evidenced your belief through your actions. He said, that in blessing I'm going to bless thee. And in multiplying, I'm going to multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven. Go ahead.
And as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies.
Go ahead.
And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed.
He said, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. And the seed that he's talking about is none other than Jesus. He's not saying seeds as in many, but seeds as in one, the one to come. Again, none other than Jesus. He said, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. So everybody is to be blessed. Why? Because Abraham was obedient unto God. Turn over to Hebrews 11. I'm sorry.
Because thou hast obeyed my voice.
Again, because he was obedient unto God, everybody has an opportunity of eternal life. See, Jesus came, and through him, he brought salvation. But that salvation came as a result of Abraham's obedience. Turn over to Hebrews 11th chapter. We're going to see why Abraham was willing to sacrifice Isaac. And it was because of a promise that God had made unto Abraham. Because when he told him he was going to give him the land of Canaan and to his seed after him, it was going to be for an everlasting possession. The only way that you can possess something forever, you have to be able to live forever. Abraham, as all of God's servants understood the resurrection. And that's why he was willing to sacrifice Isaac. Because how could he bless his seed if his seed was going to be killed? Abraham believed God. He believed the resurrection. And therefore he was willing to sacrifice his son. And that's what Paul tells us here. 11, and pick it up at verse number 1. Hebrews 11 and 1. Go ahead when you get there.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen.
He said, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. And I always say, you're not hoping as in a wish. It's a hope as an assurance. You know with all certainty that the word of God is true. And then you have to be willing to act in accordance to your belief. That's your faith. Your belief evidenced by your actions results in one's faith.